Good morning. Good morning. Man, what a great weekend it has been at Harvest Bible Chapel in Elgin. We had Wake Up going strong starting Friday night. We've got some teenagers that were smart. The 9 a.m. crew, I don't know what they were thinking getting up and out for the 9 a.m. service. Y'all are intelligent people, okay? So pour it all out for this service. Go home, stuff yourselves, tell your parents like 5 minutes worth of information about how epic the weekend was, and then go back to sleep. You don't have school tomorrow, right? So just sleep until Tuesday. That's what you should do. Well, it's been a miraculous weekend. How about this? For like 1 minute on Friday night, Pastor Tommy and Brandon and Noah and their crew pulled off a miracle in my heart. Wake Up was so epic, I actually wanted to be a teenager again. Miracle number one. Miracle number two, we asked Pastor Tommy, what was the response like on Friday night to the gospel? And he said, this area right here was so filled with students repenting and getting right with the Lord. It was too many to count. So church, I know that you've been praying that God would meet with students, and he did. So excited. So excited. Now to jump into God's word. And as we do that, let me start by telling you about my cars. Cars. Yes. I'm learning that you just can't live without them, especially when we have teenagers now that are driving. And now that we have four drivers in our family, it seems like we've suddenly acquired a fleet of vehicles. I'm pretty grateful for our cars most of the time. We have a Nissan that's almost at 200,000 miles. And get this, we have a Kia minivan with 320,000 miles. I love that car. I think Kia should give me a free one when it finally decides to die. Speaking of, old cars can get cranky. And this past month, they've all decided to get cranky at the same time. And so what do you think I did when it was time to get help for my cars? I took them to the one who is the authority on cars. I took them to the one who has the power to fix cars. I took them to my mechanic. But what about when life breaks down? Who do you go to? Well, today is going to be the last message in this mini series that we've been working through called Just Jesus at All Authority. And here's what we're going to find from our time in Mark. We're going to find that when you're enduring a storm, when you need clarity from your confusion, when you need hope for your healing, You turn to the one who has authority. You turn to the one who has power, and it's Jesus, because there's power in his presence. And so go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Mark chapter 6. We're going to pick up in verse 45, and as you're turning there, let me give you a recap of where we were just last week. Pastor Dave Stone walked us through the miracle of feeding 5,000 men. I say that because the story left out that there were probably twice or three times that many women or children. So it's really an undersell to say only five. It was more like the feeding of 12 to 15,000. And there were leftovers, 12 baskets full of leftovers, as a matter of fact. In other words, this was a story about Jesus' divine power on full display. So with that, let's pick up starting in verse 45. Immediately, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had taken leave of them, he went up on the mountain to pray. And when evening came, the boat was out on the sea, and he was alone on the land, and he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. Let's stop there and move toward this first thought, that hopefully you can see that the disciples, they're sailing against a storm. And just like they sail against storms, we face storms, right? Like the snowstorm this week or the beautiful spring storms that are just a few weeks away. But the reality is also we encounter many kinds of storms in life, don't we? And that leads to this first thought, that Jesus, he's sovereign over our storm. So this first type of storm that Jesus is sovereign over is the storm of uncertainty. Go back to the first word in verse 45, and I'll get there in just a moment. As I do that, let me just paint the picture of the story here a little bit more for you. At this point, the thousands of people's bellies are very stuffed. They're well fed. They had a very happy meal thanks to Jesus. Yet they had this insatiable appetite for a king. And because of the miracle that they just saw Jesus pull off with the fishes and the loaves, they have their sights set on making Jesus to be their savior from Rome. But Jesus can discern their uncertainty about who he is and what he came to do, which is why it says immediately, meaning firmly, swiftly, he sent the disciples on a cruise and he dismissed the crowd. They don't realize yet that Jesus came for a far greater purpose. So what does this mean for you? Like the people in this passage, I wonder, are you uncertain about who Jesus Christ is? Do you treat him like a genie, just wishing and hoping that he'll help you this time and then you promise to be good? Or do you think relating with Jesus is mostly about doing enough good to outweigh the bad? Or do you feel like Jesus is just one of the ways to get to heaven? Listen, if you're uncertain about Jesus, I want you to know, first of all, you're in good company. Not only did the people in the story have uncertainty about who Jesus is, so have I. So have I. And so have most likely every person in this room had moments of being uncertain about who Jesus is. But can I just plead with you? Can I appeal to you? Please don't get comfortable in your uncertainty about Jesus. Because what he offers to you, what he offers to you is a life that is full of freedom and full of purpose for the present, the future, and for eternity. And because Jesus is sovereign over this storm, he has made a way for it to be gone forever. And it's called repentance. Repentance is going this way down the wide road of destruction and then turning by faith to the narrow road to walk into the arms of the one who loves you, who gave his life for you. But maybe uncertainty about who Jesus is isn't your storm. Perhaps it's what we see next in the passage. So look back, starting with me in verse 46. It says, after he had taken leave of them, he went up on the mountain to pray. And when evening came, the boat was out on the sea and he was alone on the land. And he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. What this passage tells us is that Jesus, he's sovereign over the storm of hardship. And here are three observations that I found in the passage. Number one, the disciples are struggling painfully to make way on their journey. Second, Jesus actually lets them struggle. And third observation, what is Jesus doing while the disciples are struggling? He's praying. So I wonder, are you today enduring some kind of hardship? Maybe it's a hardship with a family member. Maybe it's a hardship at your work. Maybe it's a hardship with your budget or your health. Whatever it is, here's how Jesus is sovereign over that storm. What we learn from the passage is that Jesus, what does he do? He actually allows adversity into your life to teach you life-altering lessons. And can I just admit that I wish hardship were not such a good teacher? But the reality is that just like our muscles need to be pushed and pulled and stretched, which you can tell I can do a lot of that, right? In order to get bigger and stronger, right? I don't do a lot of that. But just like our muscles need to be exercised, so does our character. And life's struggles make us stronger. But here, check this out as well. The passage also assures us that Jesus isn't ignorant. He's not aloof to your suffering. While the text doesn't say explicitly what it was that Jesus was praying, I believe that because of who Jesus is, and because of the promise from Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, that Jesus always lives to make intercession for us, I believe that it is very safe to assume that while the disciples were out at sea struggling, what was Jesus doing? He was praying for them. He was interceding for them. And so if he was doing that for the disciples, then be assured, loved ones, that Jesus, today in your hardship, is praying prayers of intercession for you. Well, like I said, there are many different kinds of storms. And then there's this last one that the text says that Jesus is sovereign over, the storm of fear. Look with me back starting in verse 48, where it says, "And about the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. He meant to pass by them, but when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost. And they cried out, for they all saw him and were terrified. But immediately he spoke to them and said, 'Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid.'" Imagine the scene here, okay? This is the fourth watch of the night, which means that it was around 3 to 6 a.m. I'm sure some of our teenagers know what it's like to be up between 3 and 6 a.m., right? And it's a storm. The parallel passage to this is from Matthew chapter 14, and it's very clear in that version that this was a storm that they were sailing through, which means there was no light from the stars or the moon to help them navigate their way. The only light that they had may have come from the occasional bolt of lightning, and the wind was howling and the waves were crashing, and the disciples, they've been at this for hours. And then suddenly, through the mist of the crashing waves, the disciples see what they think is a ghost. Now, a little context here. The disciples aren't a bunch of walking dead fanatics looking for zombies around every corner, okay? In this period of history, there was actually a belief, a theory that there were spirits living around the people who would actually reveal themselves to human eyes once in a while. It was a theory. And so when the disciples see this figure out on the sea, they don't know that it's Jesus yet. They think it's a ghost. Oh my gosh, the theory is actually true. It's real. I wonder if maybe they looked a little bit like this in their terror. Okay. They were mortified. But Mark, he also describes this scene with another interesting thought. Did you catch it? Did you catch it? In verse 48, it says that Jesus meant to pass by them. Hold on. Wait a second. Are you telling me that Jesus has given them the cold shoulder? Is he? No, no. You guys don't believe in who I am. I'm just going to mosey on by, figure it out on your own. That is not at all. So glad to tell you, that is not at all what Jesus was doing. Actually, the term passing by used here is the same one used in the Old Testament accounts of when God passed by Moses and passed by Elijah to do what? To reveal him to them. That's what Jesus is doing here. This is a holy moment. He's walking on water, passing by them to reveal to the disciples his divine power. So what's the storm in your life that's stirring up fear? Is it fear about a loved one's future? Is it fear of your performance not being good enough? Is it the fear of not looking pretty enough? Is it the fear of not being smart enough? Is it the fear of not having enough money to pay the bills? Is it the fear of loneliness? Whatever your fear is, do you see? Do you see Jesus' authority and power over all of creation? Could it be that he's able to handle what concerns you today? You bet he is. You bet he is. And notice this also. I love this. The tenderness at the end of verse 50. And so in the same way that he saw the disciples' terror and moves toward them, he's moving toward you today and sees your fear. And he says, take heart. Take heart, my son. Take heart, my daughter. And he says, it is I, whatever it is, don't be afraid. In the 1800s, Charles Spurgeon was known as the Prince of Preachers. And perhaps one of the reasons why he had such a fruitful ministry was because he saw his storm of depression as a specially assigned gift from God for the benefit of the church. In fact, one biographer said Spurgeon saw his pain as a gateway into Jesus' beauty, which he then shared with others. How on earth was Spurgeon able to endure his storms with that kind of perspective? I want to know, don't you? Well, here it is. He believed in God's promises. And so here are five key promises that will help you to endure your storms. Number one, God sees you. David said in Psalm 139, where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? But God doesn't just see you, he cares for you. The psalmist said in Psalm 55, verse 22, that we could cast our burdens on him. Why? Because he cares. But what does he care about most? That leads to the third key to enduring your storms. He cares most about transforming you. What God cares is changing you into a man or a woman who's more like Jesus. That's why Paul said in Romans 8, 28 through 29, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. The good in that promise is that you would become a person who's more like Christ, thinking, talking, acting like him, that you would be more loving, more kind, more patient, more merciful. But I'll be the first one to say that that work of being changed by God feels a lot more like a crock pot than a microwave. And I wish it was happening a lot quicker than it does, which means that I struggle. I want to find the easy way out. I want to go back to what's familiar. How about you? And when you feel that way, we need to remember this loving warning, which is the fourth key to enduring your storm, and that is God's timing is best. Listen to this loving caution from Isaiah 50, verse 11. But now, all you who light fires and provide yourselves with flaming torches, go. Walk in the light of your fire and of the torches you set ablaze. And this is what you'll receive from my hand. You'll lie down in torment. Loved ones, you can make it. You can do it. You can make it through the darkness. Why? Because to God, the darkness is his light. And the fifth and final promise that will help you to endure through those difficult, stormy seasons is God is faithful. Lamentations 3, 22 to 23. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Say it with me. Great is your faithfulness. That's right. So there's power. There's power in the presence of Jesus. He is the ultimate authority, and he is in control of everything, even your storms. And now to this next thought. Jesus is clarity in your confusion. We're going to pick up in verse 51. It says, and he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased. And they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. You see, the disciples, they're confused about who Jesus is. In fact, verse 52 at the end says that their hearts were hard. This confusion about who Jesus is has caused their hearts to be hard toward him. And that is a very serious issue, to have hearts that are hard toward God. And so we need to ask why. Why were their hearts hard? Well, I would imagine that for starters, that like the well-worn hands of a tradesman, their hearts were calloused. And their calloused hearts weren't sensitive to what Jesus was trying to teach them about who he is and why it is that he came. So now we need to ask, how did their hearts get so hard? Was it because of rebellion? Was it because they were discouraged? Or was it because of some kind of ignorance? The text actually doesn't say, but what we do know from God's word is this. Ezekiel 36 promises that he is able to take hearts that are hard like stone and turn them into hearts of flesh. So are the disciples getting some clarity to their confusion as Jesus is walking on the water? Let's look back in the text. He says that they got into the boat and the wind ceased. Okay, just picture this for a minute. Jesus walks to the boat on the water. He gets up beside the boat, puts all of his weight on the water, puts one leg in the boat, brings the other in, and the wind ceases. How would you have responded in that moment? I have a feeling that you and I would have responded just like the disciples did. They were, what does it say? Utterly astounded. The translation there actually means that they were exceedingly astonished beyond their normal selves. In other words, their heads right now are exploding better. Their hearts are beginning to melt. And to try to give you just a sliver of what the disciples may have been experiencing in that moment, I want you to think for a moment of the reaction that you would have to one of these three pictures I'm going to put up on the screen. What would be the reaction that you would have to one of these moments, and then multiply it by a billion, and then we might get close to what the disciples were feeling, what was happening to them in this astounding moment. How about when you see a miraculously beautiful sunrise? Or how about the sweet birth of a baby? Or how about a, a, a shocking surprise. Jesus' authority over nature is showing the disciples that he has power. And his powerful presence is clarifying their confusion about who he is. And this clarity, it's softening their hearts. Recently, a friend was telling me about an issue that she was having with her vision. She wears glasses, but even with those glasses, she was out of focus too many times and even had the occasional moment of double vision. And so for 3 years with her doctor, they tried different prescriptions and different tests and contact lenses, all to no avail. Until just the other day, the doctor figured it out. He noticed that there was a weakness in the posture of her eye. And now that he knew what the problem was, he knew exactly how to fix it. And this is incredible. He took a prism, put it on the lens of her glass. She put the glasses on, and instantly she had crystal clear vision. And so I want to ask you a question. What is the posture of your heart today? Is your heart hard because of confusion caused by your rebellion? Is your heart hard because of confusion caused by discouragement? Or is your heart hard because of confusion caused by ignorance to the things of God? And if so, to any one of those, then how is it that we can get clarity to our confusion? Well, I believe the answer comes from a thought that I'm reading in a book by J.D. Greer. Listen to this. He says, "The vibrant Christian life is a union of clarity in the Word of God and openness to the Spirit. If we seek the Spirit of God apart from the Word of God, our faith will end in shipwreck. But in the same way, if you seek to obey the Word apart from the power of the Spirit, not only will your spiritual life be lifeless and dull, you'll also miss out on the help God wants to give you. So seek the Spirit in the Word." So here are four ways, four prayers to pray that will help you to seek the Spirit in the Word. And I would invite you to write these down in one of those blank pages in the front or back of your Bible. Four things to pray before opening your Bible. First, I stands for incline my heart to your testimonies and not to selfish gain. I got these, by the way, from a wonderful blog online. I'm excited to share this with you. This idea of inclining my heart to God's testimonies, not to selfish gain, it's not a flattering request, you guys, because it presumes that our hearts are bent in the wrong direction, away from what gives life. And I know you. It's not like you dislike your Bible. It's just that other things can so easily assume and loom larger roles in our lives. And every day, we need to be peeled away from our preoccupation with self. And the good news for you today is that God loves demagnetizing our hearts from things that are worthless and remagnetizing them to what is priceless. All for the sake of our joy, and all you need to do is ask. So I is for incline. O stands for open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. In many ways, reading the Bible is a lot like reading any other book. We should approach it thinking about who the author is and the genre of writing and the context, the author's intent. But there's one major difference between the Bible and every other book in all of human history, and it's this: the third person of the Trinity breathed out its words. And he loves bringing God's words to life day after day after day. Incline, open, and then U stands for unite. Unite my heart to fear your name. Someone once explained why it could be so hard at times to open our Bible. They said it's like Satan has his finger on the Bible, keeping it closed. And I wish I could tell you that that didn't feel so true. But the Bible says that the devil is crafty. He knows the easiest way to keep us from God's word is to distract us, to hold us captive by shiny objects that lure us away to think about something or really anything. In fact, I want to see if you recognize this moment that I'm about to demonstrate for you right now. It's the morning time, ready to have my devotion with the Lord. I got my Bible. Okay, Ephesians I was in. Chapter 2, that's right. All right, let's go. Where was I in chapter 2, by the way? All right, this part looks familiar. Man, I love the Apostle Paul. He's the man. Whew, I'm a little hungry. When was that lunch appointment today? Was it 11:30 or 12:30? You get me, don't you? Our hearts are distracted in thousands of directions so, so easily. And that's why these words from John Piper haunt me. He said, one of the great uses of Twitter and Facebook will be to prove at the last day that prayerlessness was not from a lack of time. Wow. We must, loved ones, pray earnestly for a united heart, lest we drift toward being distracted from the words of the living God. Incline, open, unite, and finally, S stands for satisfy. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love. It's not just that we're distracted from God's word, though. We're also far too easily satisfied. In a commencement address back in 2005, the author David Foster Wallace, who wasn't a Christian, said these profound words. The compelling reason to choose some sort of God to worship is that pretty much anything else you worship will eat you alive. If you worship money, you'll never feel like you have enough. Worship your body in beauty, you'll die a million deaths before they plant you. Worship power, you'll end up feeling weak and afraid and numbed by your own fear. Worship your intellect, being seen as smart, you'll end up feeling stupid and like a fraud, always on the verge of being found out. And the insidious thing about these forms of worship is they're unconscious. They're our default setting. That's why when you open God's word, you need to speak directly with the author. Ask the Spirit to unblind you to the beauty staring you in the face. As Spurgeon said, texts will often refuse to reveal their treasures to you till you open them with the key of prayer. How about these prayers? So not only does Jesus' powerful presence make him sovereign over your storm and clarify your confusion, now we're going to see that he, and this is the last point, is hope for your healing. Pick up with me in verse 53. When they had crossed over, they came to land at Gennesaret and moored to the shore. And when they got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized him and ran about the whole region and began to bring the sick people on their beds to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he came, in villages, cities, or countryside, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and implored him that they might touch him, even the fringe of his garment. And as many touched it, were made well. Word had spread like wildfire about Jesus and his ministry. And so when they pulled up to the shore, they recognized immediately who he was. And an interesting note about the grammar here, did you see it? The action verbs here are not about Jesus. They're describing what the people are doing. They're the ones running. They're the ones taking the initiative to go to be with Christ. What I'm also struck by in this passage is that the account tells us that all who touched him were made well. The emphasis here isn't so much on the people's faith like the bleeding woman in Mark 5. Instead, the spotlight here is on Jesus' ministry of healing, a ministry of compassion, and a ministry of power. It was Jesus' compassion that drove him to heal powerfully, and it was Jesus' power that moved him to bring compassionate healing. It's both. And did you notice how Mark describes the people once they came to Jesus? Wherever they found him, the text says that they implored him. That means that they were making strong requests of the Lord. They weren't polite. They weren't bashful. They were demanding. They were desperate. And they were doing what desperate people do. They didn't care how much effort it took. They didn't care at all what other people thought about them. They finally knew that in their presence was power, the power that they needed for healing. And that's why they had hope. And so what does this mean for you? I want you to see the people's desperation. I want you to see their zeal to come to Jesus. And this past Thursday, I caught a glimpse of what it might be like to come to Jesus like this. I was at the worship night in Rolling Meadows, and next to me was a young man with special needs. And oh, how I wish you could have seen this guy worship Jesus as he was lifting his knees high and spinning in circles and lifting his arms up and not singing even close to being on key. And you know what? He didn't care. Because he was coming to Jesus just as he is, accepted and confident. So get this. Hebrews 4:16 says, "Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." We too can come to Jesus like the people in this story. But I get that this notion of coming desperate to Jesus is really foreign to us. Frankly, it's even un-American. I mean, if I got a problem, I'll just Google it, right? I can just buy it on Amazon and I'll have it tomorrow. Or I'll pull myself up by my bootstraps and I'll just power up and over it. But can I just appeal to you that you would let go of that false self of power, strength? Let go, break the mold of self-reliance today. Today. We started this time by saying that when you need help, you go to the one who has authority. You go to Jesus because there's power in his presence. This is Jesus. And he's reaching through the storm, walking on the water, even when he couldn't see. In the middle of it all, when you thought he was 1,000 miles away, not for a moment, not ever, Has he or will he forsake you? And so in the same way that we saw the people in this passage running to be with Jesus, I want you to know that right now, the front of the church is now open. Open for you to come, to be with him in whose presence there is power. And so let your physical action today, let that physical action of you coming forward here in a moment be the statement to God that you recognize, let it be a statement to your own soul even, that you recognize that the power that you need is found in Jesus alone. And so perhaps you're in a storm of uncertainty, uncertain about who Jesus is to you. And so make today the day, would you, that you turn from your sin and run into the arms of Jesus for forgiveness. Jesus is offering you freedom. He's offering you purpose. Why would you delay? Why would you settle for anything less than that? Turn and come today to Jesus. Repent and believe in him. Or perhaps you're in a storm of hardship or fear. And you know what? The most difficult thing about those kinds of storms isn't so much how hard they are, but their length. If you're honest today, you would admit, oh God, I just don't know that I can make it another day. I need a fresh filling of your power, Lord. And so the front is open to you to come and to receive the power that he's so willing to give to you to help you endure this storm. Or maybe your heart is hard, hardened by confusion, confused because of your rebellion. Maybe your heart is confused and hardened because of just immense discouragement. Or maybe ignorance to who Jesus is. Can I just tell you that Jesus is offering you forgiveness today? He's offering you deliverance today. He's offering you enlightenment and knowledge. And all you need to do is come. Well, why would you continue to walk on a path of confusion, trying to figure out your way, walking in the dark when Jesus is offering you the light? He's offering you clarity. Come. He's willing today, right now, to offer you clarity to your confusion. Or maybe you're like the people that we just learned about who need healing. You need healing. And maybe your healing need is because of sin that was committed against you. And I'm so sorry if that's the case. Or maybe it's because of sin you've committed against yourself. Whatever the hurt is, whether it's mental or physical or emotional, Jesus right now is here waiting, willing you to come forward so that he could heal you in love. And there's no shame in coming forward. In fact, it takes courage. It's what brave people do. And it's get this, it takes the faith the size of a mustard seed. It takes faith as simple as a child's faith. So we're gonna sing, and as we begin to sing, I just want to invite you, come forward. This is a church, we're full of broken people. There's no shame in coming forward. And then we'll take a moment to pray for you. But let's sing right now, not for a moment. You are reaching through the storm.